Hello and welcome to the session. This is Professor Farhat. In this session, we're going to be looking at foreign direct investments. We're going to define it and look at opportunities and challenges when it comes to foreign direct investments. This topic is covered in an international accounting course, and it could be also covered on the CPA exam. As always, I would like to remind you, my viewers, to connect with me on LinkedIn. If you don't have a LinkedIn account, you should create one. LinkedIn is very important for your professional image and professional networking. YouTube is where I house all my lectures. Please subscribe to my channel, like my videos, share them, put them in the playlist, let the world know about them. If they're benefiting you, if you're listening to me, it means they may benefit other people. Please share the wealth. It's free for everyone. I'm growing my followers on Instagram. Please follow me on Instagram and like my Facebook page. If you want any premium CPA material, please go to my Gumroad account. I also have a website where I organize some of my lectures over there. So foreign direct investment. What is foreign direct investments? As we talked earlier, what happened is we might have a U.S. company. And what they would do, they would buy, they would sell, and they would buy from a foreign company. So that's what they do. They would buy and they sell from a foreign company. Well, another way to get involved in international account, international business, which when I get you into international accounting, is to go ahead and move the part of the U.S. company into the foreign territory. So this is called foreign direct investments. Now, how would you carry on foreign direct investments? It's when you own and control foreign asset. You go to that foreign country and you operate in that foreign country. How would you do it? You either buy an existing company, like you would buy another manufacturers, another retailer, another software company. You would buy, you invest in an existing operation, you would buy them, or you would start your own company. It's called greenfield investments. You will just start your own branch over there. So new operation in the foreign country. Those are the two ways that you would do it. Now, how would you do it? It all depends on what is your objective, what are your resources, you study the market, so on and so forth, and you have to do what's called a net present value analysis, okay, to make sure it's worth moving into that country or that territory. Now, what are the reasons for foreign direct investments? Obviously, the reason we do business is to make profit. So one thing is to increase sales and profit. You might have a larger market. You might have a larger market where you can sell more. You can obtain new technology. You might want to enter this rapidly growing or emerging market. For example, the rate of growth in a foreign country might be higher than the rate of growth in your local country. So you want to gain a foothold, because the earlier you are, generally speaking, the earlier you start something, the better off are the results in a business. Why? Because you are an early starter, you have more experience, people are coming to you because you existed there longer than others, generally speaking. So you want to get a foothold as early as possible. You might be able to reduce your cost. You might be able to get your production closer to the supplier. So basically, rather than shipping components from overseas, you can take your production overseas, thus eliminating transportation costs, and it could be cheaper to operate those. So you could have lower means of production if you operate in a foreign country. Gain a foothold in economic blocks. What are the economic blocks? Well, it could be NAFTA, which again, this might change. NAFTA might change. It could be the EU, and who knows, the EU might change down the road, or you could be part of the Asian bloc. And basically, what is the Asian bloc? You're talking about China, Malaysia, the Philippines, all these countries. And once you get a foothold there in one of these countries, then you have access to the whole bloc. Okay, so you would reduce restriction on your product, on your buying, on your selling, and you might be able to remove some tariffs, which is in turn make your product more competitive. Okay, also another way to move overseas is to protect your domestic market. What you do is you go to the competitor and you will try to weaken your international competitor by entering their home market. And what happens is you put them on the defense. Now they need to defend their market. They may not even move into your foreign market anymore. So that's another way to go with that foreign direct investments. or to protect your market. So what you do is you want, what you do is you want to protect your established market in that country. So you keep on adding investments in that foreign country because you need to protect your foreign market because you have a foreign market. And the last is you want to acquire technology and managerial know-how. Maybe you can conduct research and development at lower cost in those countries, or maybe hire experienced management or employee from competitors. Once you are there, you know what the market looks like, and those are all positives. So this is why you would want to operate or go and make foreign direct investments. It's either you buy an existing company overseas or you start your own company. Now, obviously, there are challenges and opportunities to foreign direct investments. So we're going to list some of the challenges, and I'm going to go over each one briefly. The first one is financial reporting for foreign operation. You have to follow certain guidance. International taxation, international income taxation, international transfer pricing, performance evaluation for foreign operation, international auditing, and sustainability report. So we're going to go, if you listen to my lectures, every time I have a list, that means I'm going to go over these lists separately. The first one is financial reporting for foreign operation. What does that mean? It means you have to translate and you have to convert your financial operation into US. Again, I'm talking US as the home country. So what you have to do, steps in that foreign operation, is you have to convert from local to US GAAP. So you have to go from the local accounting method to the US method. So you have to prepare your financial statement using US GAAP, then you have to translate from local currency to US dollar. Okay, so now you have to record or prepare using local currency. What you have to do, you have to translate that currency. And we're gonna learn more about translation down the road. Those are just, I'm just giving you an overview. This is the challenges that you're gonna have to have. Sometimes this process is easy, sometimes it's more challenging. Sometimes the currency that the foreign country is using, it could be the US dollar, makes it easier. Sometimes you could be operating in a country where they're using a local currency other than that country itself. So it gets a little bit more complicated. Don't worry about this for now. We're going to talk about translation and conversion later on, how you convert financial statements, how you translate transactions. So, but this is a challenge that you have to deal with. Another challenge is international income taxation. The question becomes, how much do you pay taxes in the local country and how much do you pay taxes in your home jurisdiction? For example, if you are a US company that's operating in Ireland, what's gonna happen is you have to pay taxes in Ireland and you have to pay taxes in the US. What does that mean? It means you might have double taxation. So you're gonna have foreign income taxes. Well, when you make a profit in Ireland, you have to pay taxes there. Then the US says, well, you have to pay taxes on your worldwide income, so you have to pay taxes on your foreign-based income. Now, bear in mind, there are tax treaties that relieve this double taxation. And this is where you need experts at your side to make sure you understand when you are moving to a certain country, what are the tax consequences? Or if there's no treaties, you might have to pay both taxes. But most of the time for the US, we do have treaties, but you cannot always count on this. So the objective is to legally minimize taxes in a foreign country. Okay, to maximize your cash flow. And what happened in most places, for example, in the US, when you pay taxes overseas, you'll get a foreign tax credit. Simply put, they'll give you credit for the taxes you paid overseas. And there are specific rules. Again, there's one whole chapter about this. We'll talk about this later, but this is what we need to know. Okay, so you want to have expertise on your side when you are dealing with taxes. Actually, you have to have expertise even if you're not international, even if you are domestic. Okay. Another issue we have to deal with is international transfer pricing. And what is international transfer pricing? It's when one company sells or buy product from a sister company. For example, we are in the US, so this is a US company, US of A, and we have a subsidiary in Ireland. And what happened is we're going to be, the subsidiary in Ireland need some sort of a product, parts from the US. So we manufacture the parts in the US, and we sell them to the Ireland company. And what they do, they manufacture the product in Ireland. The question becomes, how much do we charge the Irish company? Well, guess what? Here are the facts. So just to give you an example, just see why this is important in the real world. Let's assume in Ireland we have a low tax rate, and in the US we have a high tax rate. So the US company pay high taxes on their profit, the Irish company, they pay low taxes in Ireland. Okay, so what's going to happen is we're going to have to find a way to minimize our taxes. So what does that mean? Well, what do you think should happen here? Well, the U.S. company should sell at low prices. Why? Because for the U.S. company, every time they make a sale, they have a revenue. And they want to minimize their revenue, okay? Generally speaking, they don't want to minimize their revenue, but you want to minimize your revenue because you're selling to a sister company, to a subsidiary. So if you're selling to your subsidiary, their cost is lower too. So let's assume you sold them something for $1,000. Their cost is $1,000. Their cost becomes $1,000. Your revenue to you is a cost to them. But what you want to do, you want to sell them at the lowest selling prices. Why? Because you don't want to be taxed too much on this revenue, because it's that whatever you sold them, it's going to come back and the Irish company will have to pay taxes with the US as well. So what happened is you would let the taxes be paid in Ireland, which is they have a lower tax rate. That's what transfer pricing is in a nutshell. Not this is what it is. This is a basic application of it. We're going to have a whole chapter about transfer pricing, but this is what we have to deal with. Okay? So when the issue for multinational companies making intercompany sales, one company sells the other. Company uses discretionary transfer pricing. Discretionary means it's what they want to charge each other. Okay? Price negotiation between buyer and seller may not be feasible due to tax rate differences. So what's going to happen is they're going to have to find the best way to reduce their taxes. Okay, so what's going to happen? Companies will shift from countries from high tax rate to countries with low tax rate. And this is the example of what I'm trying to say here. What you do is when you sell to the Irish company, you sell them, the US company will sell them at a low prices. This way they don't have to show a lot of revenue in the US. And the Irish company will have low cost. Low cost means higher profit. Higher profit means they'll pay more taxes in Ireland because more taxes relative to the US, it's lower taxes because it's a lower tax rate. Okay. Now bear in mind that countries are aware that companies do so. So countries regulate international transfer pricing to ensure companies pay their fair share of local taxes. And again, we'll talk about this topic much more about transfer pricing, but this is basically, in a sense, an introduction or topics that we're going to be dealing with down the road. International transfer pricing is one whole chapter, I believe. Another issue that we have to deal with is performance evaluation of foreign operation. What does that mean? It means making sure the units, the foreign unit is achieving their objective. How do we make sure it's achieving its objective? We go through evaluation through periodic report on individual unit performance. So we just basically evaluate their performance, and this is what you learn in managerial accounting. How do we, you know, we have to make sure they're meeting their objective in terms of sales, in terms of a gross profit, return on investment, so on and so forth. Okay, so when we are dealing with those type of situation, we have to make sure we're aware of the translation from one currency into the other. Are we using the euro? The euro to judge them? Are we using the US dollar? What about the transfer pricing? Are we using inflated prices on purpose? Are we selling them? Are we selling them parts with high prices on purpose because of transfer pricing? So we have to make sure we take into those we take those issues into consideration when we are evaluating the performance of a foreign operation. Also, there might be some issues unique to that foreign operation. International auditing, same concept in a sense. You want to make sure that the foreign subsidiary is following policies and procedures. You might have an internal auditing component of the management to control the process. Basically, you have people inside the company doing internal control, making sure they are following company's policies, company's procedures. You want to make sure the internal auditing is uncovering errors, inefficiencies, and possible fraud. And you want to make sure they are following the FCPA, which is the Foreign Corruption Practice Act. This is very important in the US. For example, you cannot bribe officials if you are a US company. Okay? Some countries, they're okay with this. Basically, some countries, they accept the bribes as a form of business. If you're a US company, that's a violation of the Foreign Corrupt Practice Act. You cannot use bribe to conduct your business. Now, issues faced by internal and external auditors, the issues could be numerous. If they send you as an external auditor, or if you're an internal auditor sent from the US, it could be different in language, cultures, many other things. I mean, I will tell you as an auditor, as a former auditor, Even in the U.S., within the same town, you will find differences and challenges when you are conducting an audit. So let alone if you go to audit a foreign subsidiary, the language, the culture, the business customs, so on and so forth, there's so much differences. Okay. Also add to that differences in accounting standard and auditing standard. The way we do accounting in the U.S., it's different. The way we do auditing, it's different. It's not that much different, but there are major differences. Okay. Also, another challenge for direct financial reporting is cross listing. What does cross listing mean? It means you want to be, for example, a US company. Let's assume Apple. Apple, they can raise money in the US, but let's assume they want to raise money in Europe. CAC 40, like the or FTSE 100 in England. What they have to do before you are listed, you have to translate your financial statement to whatever regulation that the stock exchange would like you to comply with. Okay, so listing regulation differ for foreign companies. So if you are a U.S. company trying to list your company in Japan, you have to follow their policies and procedures. Well, if you're using GAAP, you might have to use IFRS. In some countries, they might accept GAAP. Some companies, you have to convert to IFRS before you list your company on their exchange. Also, sustainability reporting or sustainability value report or corporate social responsibilities or corporate responsibility report, those are voluntary reports that are required in several countries. They may not be required in your home country, for example, the US. For example, information about the environmental impact, which is we are already starting to do so and integrate that information in our annual reports, labor practices, product safety, innovation, depending on the country that you are in. For example, product safety is very important in Europe. I know my wife works with Johnson & Johnson, and they are much, much stricter when it comes to medical devices than the US. So you have to disclose this information in your report. What could solve all of that? Not solve, but make this much easier is global accounting standard. Basically required countries to adopt common set of accounting rules. So if there is only one set of rules, let's assume an international gap, then all countries will follow the same rules. This will avoid conversion from one method to another, and it'll be easier to evaluate foreign investment opportunities because now you don't need to convert and make adjustments before you make a decision. If we are all using the same accounting method, then it's easier to evaluate the performance and profitability of a company. This is basically in a nutshell, foreign direct investments. If you have any questions about this recording, email me. If you're studying for your CPA exam, make sure you study hard. If you happen to visit my website for additional lectures, please consider donating. Good luck and study hard.